Last week, I had the opportunity to sit down in person with superg, the creator of the gscart and gcomp switches. I had a great time talking to him, but unfortunately, my mic went out about halfway through the interview, so I ended up having to use a backup source for my parts. But his mic was perfect the whole time, which, in my opinion, is all that really matters for interviews like this. You know, there's nothing you could do about stuff like this when you're doing it all by yourself and you don't have anybody else to sit there and verify audio or video or anything. Things like this are just going to happen, but you could still hear him the whole time and you could hear me good enough. So sorry if it annoys anybody, but either way, I think it's a great interview and I'm pretty sure you guys are going to enjoy it as much as I did. So without further ado, here's an interview with superg. Hey guys, I am here with superg. What's up, man?
Hey, how are you?
Good. So I gotta ask, I've asked you this before, but I always am a stickler with name pronunciation. What is the proper way to pronounce your name? Because I always get it wrong.
My real name.
Your real name.
Right, okay.
Superg, I'm saying that right, correct?
I got superg that part. Is perfect. Right. Yeah, superg is perfect.
Okay.
So, how American people say it, it's Hennady.
Okay.
My first name, how they say it in Ukraine is Hennady.
Okay.
Not H, but H. It's okay. Like different sound.
So yeah. It's not offensive for somebody to call you Hennady?
No.
Okay, it's just the American
pronunciation. You can call me anything you want. Just don't call me late for dinner. I know this.
Yeah. I always try to get it right. And it's weird because for me, like, I feel like I want to make sure I'm respectful, but for product names, I get those wrong all the time, and I don't care. It's only a person's name that I worry
and
about.
My name is unusual. Mm-hmm. Like, from Ukrainian perspective, it's kind of longer name, so we tend to use, like, simpler names, but mm-hmm. It's just... I was named in honor of my grandfather, who is also has the same name, and it's like this. Yeah, nickname is Gena. So, Hennady is Gena.
Okay.
So, if Gena is simpler, but if I... when I spell it, it's G-E-N-A. And if I tell it to somebody, it's Gina. And Gina is woman's name. So it's
in America, yeah.
Yeah, so it's...
Yeah, that's funny. Because I have a lot of friends from Ukraine, Russia, that whole area, and I've heard Gennady before pronounced with a G, but never with an H.
G is kind of Russian notation of my name. So like Russian people, when they talk to me, they tend to say Gennady.
Okay.
Yeah, in Ukraine it's just instead of G, we use H, like soft G.
I'm always fascinated by stuff like that.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I'm not worried about somebody calling me wrong. It's fine. It's just for me, it's matter just understanding that somebody is talking to me. So
for some reason, whenever I'm doing the weekly roundups, sometimes superg is a tongue twister. So you gotta try to, like, you know, Super G's new G-scart. Sometimes I end up, like, messing up the word all the time. So maybe I'll just say Hennady from now on because that'll be easier.
And anything you want. So Super G has another story. So
please.
My nickname is G, mm-hmm. which is kind of Gennady, mm-hmm. using Russian notation. Mm-hmm. But one letter you cannot use, like, anywhere when you register, let's say, in some forums. Mm-hmm. So I had to add something before or something after. And I decided, okay, there is G, there's Superman, there is...
Super Mario?
Yeah. Super G.
That's awesome. Yeah, that was going to be my next question, is how you get Super G, but that's cool. I like that. Huh. So for anybody that's not familiar, and I'm assuming everybody watching this is, Hennady is the creator of the G-scart switch and the G-comp switch, both a scart and component automatic switch. And it is, in my opinion, the best one by far. I'm not saying that because I'm friends with them. I'm saying that because of years of testing of this thing. So as anybody that works with me knows, if I find a problem, I'm not going to be an asshole. I'm not going to go and tell the world, look at this. I'll talk to the creator first, but I haven't really seen any issues, and anything that we've found over the years are things that, like, you only find these issues after hundreds of people test with every combination of things.
Right.
You know what I mean? So it's I've seen the evolution from the beginning. I absolutely love it. I love all of the different steps that that you've added to it, where it's not just a switch anymore. Does the sync regeneration? All of the voltage levels are good. It's now safe from evil super guns that might try to try to blow it up. So how? What was the origin of this? What made you start and say, I want to build a SCART switch?
Yeah. Okay. So when I moved here 6 years ago, we rented a house, which is kind of bigger than what I used to live in before, because mm-hmm. in Ukraine, mm-hmm. in my native city Lviv, mm-hmm. so we lived in apartment. Usually people live in apartments. Those are big buildings, 10 floors, mm-hmm. and you don't really get enough space just to have a proper setup. Mm-hmm. And I had my stuff in storage. I had my my NES, my Genesis stuff, Mega Drive. Sorry. my PlayStation, and it's all in storage. So basically, you want to play something, you have to take it out, connect, play. Now I moved here, and here in the US, space is not an issue. So it feels very good, when you jump into something and you get a lot of space. And
yeah, I live in Manhattan, so I know what it's like to have no space whatsoever. So I understand exactly what you're talking about.
Yeah, and basically I've got a full basement for my own use, like man's cave, and I started to set something up, and I had my uncle visiting who works on wood, and I said, hey, what if we do some kind of shelving units for my consoles, here one. So we did some. It was ugly. Mm-hmm. Now that I remember it was ugly. But I have a space, and I started, to put all my consoles. When we moved here, my family, so I took all of my European stuff with me. Mm-hmm. So it was whole half of container of all my stuff. Basically, it was mainly PAL consoles, mm-hmm. some Japanese stuff, some American stuff, which I purchased on American eBay and got it cheap using overpriced overseas carriers. Mm-hmm. And yeah, so basically I got it all here, and nobody wanna switch cables. And my dad is electrical engineer, mm-hmm. and I told him, hey, look, what if I create this just simple device for me, and then maybe I will sell to somebody else just to get money back, basically just to make it even. And that's how it started. It was, I think my thread is still on Assembler Games, that first one. So mm-hmm. I'm not reading it, but I'm subscribed. Nobody is, so it lost its old one. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I told my dad, hey, I need this. And we thought about it a bit. I say, okay, we talked about solutions. So mm-hmm. I'm basically, I'm software engineer. Mm-hmm. So hardware.
Your day job is software engineering?
What's that?
Your day job is software engineering?
Yes, mm-hmm. Full-time day job. Mm-hmm. I got promoted to manager recently, but nice. it's not even announced, so it's going to happen somewhere next week.
Cool.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
But, thanks. Yeah, and so I know a lot of stuff about it. It's just I write code. Mm-hmm. This is my main occupation. And yeah, we came up with some switch, so I've been testing, I've been ordering some stuff in China, you probably remember that. So it was bare PCB, I was soldering everything in my basement.
Oh, yeah, it's a lot of components to solder together.
Yeah, so first 50 units were soldered by me, mm-hmm. every component. Now I said, it's unbearable,
yeah,
really. And we started to switch to cheaper cases. To cheaper ICs like TSSOP cases, and it just started to be hard, and I don't get any time for this. And then slowly improved. Passive switch became active switch with all the complaints, bug fixes, DC restore features, then Altera. Mm-hmm. And the moment you get Altera, it's FPGA, its opportunities are endless. Mm-hmm. So just then you start cleaning the digital cleaning, the sync, then you add features, then most important is now sync and green. Mm-hmm. So, and yeah, it's almost done. But yeah, protection from supergun and whatnot. Yeah.
You know, it's funny, so many people who create things like that, it's a similar origin story in that they really just built one thing for themselves, and then some of their friends were like, hey, can I have one too? And next thing you know, they're selling them. Akari said that, Crick said that about his Genesis cart, so it's funny. A lot of this stuff, it's just we're trying to solve the problems for ourselves, and we realize other people want it, part of it too, so that's cool.
Right, and first version of Switch, there were only 10 items. And as output, I've chosen Mini DIN, the one which is used in FrameMeister, like exactly the same pinout, and I was soldering all the cables myself. Oof. It was, I hate that. Still, like really those tiny pins, and you have to solder it all. So yeah, then I finally, we decided to do a SCART output. Then it was VGA output, which was technically SCART also, and now finally, it's two SCART outputs.
So you said you worked on it with your dad, who's an electrical engineer. How did you start? Did you just download the SCART specs and try to make everything fall within the range? And I guess just basically tackle it both as a gamer and as an electrical engineer at the same time.
Yeah, it was basically, yeah, we talked about specs. So I said there is SCART, which is connector. It carries like RGB, best possible signal, which we can get from analog. Now, like I know this like console part, I know some electronics basics. My dad is like really into electronics. So, and it was like, yeah, so kind of, I was a guy who make a decisions. I still is. He helps me with that. Now, as of today, let's say if some switch is broken, like all electronics part, I fix everything myself. I know everything, obviously, because so many iterations and so many users and some complaints always. So yeah, what I don't do FPGA. So FPGA part is written by my dad still today. So yeah, we are waiting for him right now to do sync and green stuff. Well, it's basically done. It's a matter of configuration. And yeah, there were some issues for this like newest version, which are resolved as of today.
So just to walk through the different versions, the original prototypes for yourself, you said, were a manual switch. And then the first...
Passive
switch.
Passive, right.
And then the first one that I saw was... it was the original design of one SCART output, one D sub VGA output was the original one that I saw.
3.0, it was starting 3.0, yeah.
And that one had a THS7374 chip, and which allows dual output because it could have double the load on it without hurting any of the consoles and all that stuff. That was great. That one, I had no problems with it. Very little signal degradation. And when I say little, you have to zoom in 100 times to see, you know, like all the way into link space to see anything. Much better than all the rest. I did some tests where I added a low pass filter switch, which was cool because some people with the setups wanted on and off. And the D sub was something that a lot of people really needed who do any kind of like arcade stuff. So they need TTL level voltage output, things like that. So that was pretty handy. And then you moved on to what you're now calling the light, which you might want to think about changing the name because there's nothing light about it. This is a very heavy feature pack, awesome
thing. I changed it back. So the initial idea was I came up with this like 3.4 version, which had one VGA and one SCART output. And then I thought it's too pricey, really, because I still think the stuff is pricey. It's expensive. It's expensive to make, but in the quantities
order. It's not pricey. You've talked about this before. I've talked about this, and I helped sell one batch. It's not pricey because you're adding on a huge markup. It's pricey because the component cost alone is very expensive, and people seem to forget about shipping parts together. It doesn't matter how perfect you are. Sometimes shipments are going to get lost. Things are going to get broken. You end up having to eat the cost of that. People don't seem to realize, like, if how much less money is made on items than it is. So yeah, I would say it is an expensive device, but you get what you pay for. You know, it's expensive for all the right reasons, I guess. But yeah, the 3.4, you know, it added a lot of extra components. Now yeah, the D sub connectors and all that. So that yeah. So the light did cut off quite a bit of cost from that.
Yeah, so yeah, it was a light version was supposed to be cheaper for everybody, and it was cheaper for everybody. So, but then it went out so good, and it's just for me, it's so much easier to maintain just one version at a time. So, because I'm a busy guy, and it's just I want to maintain one version at a time. And don't release previous version. Still, I support it all.
So you're just calling it the gscart switch?
Yes, it was renamed back.
Okay,
now.
That makes sense.
V5.1.
No, I like that. Revision number, it's easy to track. So for anybody that hadn't followed the project, when I got the first version of the light in, I'll admit I was going back and forth, like, am I going to miss the VGA port? Am I going to miss the audio? But as soon as I started doing the testing on it, and I did the zoom in, you know, on Link's head, zoom in on Sonic and all that, I didn't see any signal noise whatsoever, any more than you would directly into the capture card. Because any analog signal is always going to have something, anything, a speck, a color difference, whatever. But was that intentional, or was that just something that happened because you had now upgraded the parts again and that added things? I mean, how did you get it so perfect? Was it just, good engineering?
I would say, like, I'm grateful to my dad for that, because he is, like, he's perfectionist. Mm-hmm. So am I. Mm. But with his expertise, it was done according to the specs. Mm. So it's really no compromise from my side. So it has to be done properly, proper attenuation, like proper components, like lowest tolerance as possible. Mm-hmm. Well, I'm not talking ultra expensive stuff and really like golden connectors.
No, I mean,
or this.
Yeah,
yes, exactly.
So, I mean, as much as we're all perfectionists in this, there is absolutely a limit to where you can't see a difference anymore.
Right.
So I don't think, to be honest, I don't think you could see just with your eyes a difference between the gscart 3.4 and now the 5. I don't think even on an OLED TV in 4K, I don't think you'd be able to see the difference. You'd have to zoom in and analyze it. So it's at the point now where, like, there's no, it would serve no purpose trying to put even higher quality components in. You've got it. You nailed it. It is good. And the outputs have always matched what they were supposed to be as well. So recently I got an oscilloscope finally this year. I've been doing a lot of testing, learned a lot. Steve from HD Retrovision especially taught me a bunch of tricks, one of which is that you really should use the probes for certain things. So remember the problem I saw on the gscart that was my cables. I was using cheap cables, BNC cables. So it was cool. It was good. I like to find stuff like that. But I went back and tested all the versions of the switch that I had, and they'd all output the proper voltage for video, all the proper for sync, and also the connector matched. So if you have the VGA output, it mm-hmm. was TTL level sync,
right.
Which is why that solved all the problems with the Extron devices, the arcade stuff that requires the higher level sync. And then same thing with the newer versions. Everything's right where it's supposed to be, without sync regeneration turned on. How is sync handled without, when the sync regeneration is not on? Is it just passed through?
It passed through. Basically, it goes through multiplexer circuit and okay. like the like easiest possible path.
So basically, if you have a cable that is outputting 350 millivolts or on one console, that spits out 350. If your next cable puts out 450, it's, you know, just whatever comes in goes out then. And then when you turn the sync regeneration on, it always is the same level, no matter what you go into it. Is that true?
Yes, kind of. So, well, this, when we speak about the sync processing, it's like two parts. Mm-hmm. First part is detection. Mm-hmm. And detection is very dynamic, because mm-hmm. you can get AC sync, you can get DC sync, you can get it shifted. So basically how it works, the signal comes, it doesn't matter how, it's only sync. So there is a ADC, mm-hmm. Which samples on a high rate what we get here. And then we have a comparator which dynamically sets level. So mm-hmm. let's say if you get like signal, let's say 350 millivolts, mm-hmm. It's gonna go through some sampling and it's gonna decide detection level. And it's always going to be lower. Mm-hmm. And this way we can detect like everything. So it's here, if it's here, still it's going to get triggered because level changes dynamically.
So you're talking about the, if you're looking like on a scope, the waveform, you're making sure
yes,
that you get
exactly.
above and below
yes.
it so that you capture the entire signal,
yeah.
even if there's a spike or a dip. That's awesome.
Yeah, so it's kind of, you kind of integrate the signal. Mm-hmm. So it's basically, it's like area of this and area of negative pulses. Mm-hmm. And we are setting this level, and this is detection. Now, when it's when it gets detected, it goes like straight to Altera, mm-hmm. which kind of which marks those which time those negative sync pulses, mm-hmm. and it just outputs it like totally on a proper level on the output while forwarding RGB.
Okay.
So basically, well, now we process G because of sync on green. So the same circuit is doing sync on G, sync on green.
So that basically then it'll take your green signal, it'll remove just the green and spit yes. that out on the green channel, and then pull the sync off of that and decide where it's going in the chips?
Yeah, so the plan for sync on green is we either fully extract it, because mm-hmm. I would say this is like most proper mode, remove sync pulses from green, because depends on your monitor, it can detect RGB level differently based on that, mm-hmm. like amplitude. Mm-hmm. So this has to be done. If you want to make it properly, and we want to make it properly, mm-hmm. so then like Altera does those like regenerates those sync pulses, which mm-hmm. are being output using correct voltage. So it's this is like rough idea how it works.
That's awesome.
Yeah, and it's all done in FPGA.
So so it actually removes the sync from green. So when green keeps going out to the displays, it has no sync signal on it
yes.
whatsoever.
Yes, okay. But again, there is going to be an option. Mm-hmm. There is an option on DIP switch, which is going to switch if you want to. By default, it's going to remove mm-hmm. Sync pulses from green. But mm-hmm. If you want to still preserve it, it was proposed by one forum user. His nickname is Dirk Swizzler.
Yeah.
He proposed a lot of nice ideas actually, mm-hmm. and so there is an option. Mm-hmm. And you can still preserve it for purists, given that you use OSSC. So yeah. It has like native RGBS, RGSB mode, and yeah. that's I would say that's for this.
I would think that your average person wouldn't need that, but it's really yeah. great that they have the option, because you never know. What if you're going into one of those Sony monitors that does read sync on green? So yeah, it's cool that there are options there for that.
Yeah, and the other option is whether you want to do a full RGSB to RGBS conversion, mm-hmm. or you just want to pass through. So this okay. is going to be like two sync on green related options. Mm-hmm. The other one is everybody's familiar with. It's clear sync or mm-hmm. sync regeneration. And yeah, and the last option, there are two things. Mm-hmm. Like first thing, which I kind of announced, it's going to just disable LED, because apparently some people don't like it like being on mm-hmm. all the time. But now there is another option we talked with you about, which is generate those horizontal sync impulses in vBlank.
Yeah, so that's a problem that there are certain Sony BVM monitors. One of them, the reason it's so high profile, is the A-series BVMs with that rare and expensive BKM right. 68X card have an issue where Sega Master System, Dreamcast, PC Engine, Neo Geo, and I think PAL Mega Drives all have issues with the sync. So at best, it curves the top, so the game's pretty much unplayable. At worst, it's like on Dreamcast, it goes completely crazy. So that's an issue that it happened with a bunch of different model BVMs, but the fact that it was, I mean, imagine spending $5,000-$6,000 for a monitor, and then out of that money, $2,000 was the input card,
right,
and
right.
then you can't even use your consoles on it. So, yeah, if it's possible to correct that in the sync regeneration, you're going to make a lot of people very happy.
Yeah, so this is the plan, but I let the cat out of the bag, and I talked about it on forums, mm-hmm. and now people start asking me, like, really, are you going to include this now, or do we have to ship it back, and shipping from Europe is expensive, mm-hmm. and I regret a bit I said that, because it's really now people are gonna like ask for it, and I think what's gonna happen, I will try to implement it sooner, and like as everybody knows, I have like two sub batches, so currently all the pre-orders, mm-hmm. it's like small first batch, mm-hmm. and the big one, which is gonna cover everybody else. Mm-hmm. So the moment I have everything for first batch, I'm ordering the second one, I ship the first one. But now I'm gonna send an email to everybody who's in the first batch. Mm-hmm. Just, guys, do you wanna wait for the feature, or do you wanna get it now? Mm-hmm.
Well, that's a really nice thing to do, because if you have a Sony PVM, or if you're just going into the OSSC, this problem doesn't exist. It's
right.
only for certain BVM owners.
Right.
And I think certain capture cards, this might be a help as well. But yeah, that's nice of you to offer that then.
Yeah, from technical perspective, we have everything. Mm-hmm. Altera works on 40 megahertz. It's enough to process Full HD progressive. Mm-hmm. It's fine. Just matter of timing the syncs and injecting the sequence at proper times.
So you have, now because of this new upgrade, you have the ability to pass through RGBS in 480p, 720p, and I think 1080i as well.
Although yes.
Don't use
yes.
1080i. The interlaced resolution looks terrible. But but yeah, that's pretty awesome. And I think you said this also has the ability to pass through component video, right?
Yes, as a kind of side effect.
So I've said this a lot, and I want to say it one more time to be clear. This does not convert component to RGB. This passes through. Because I know a very common scenario, and I'm one of these people, is that people have all RGB consoles,
right,
and then one component video console.
And they want to get it in the same place.
If you have 7 RGB in one component, this is perfect. Just get an adapter, pass it right through. You can get some high quality adapters. RetroAccess is making one, and a few other people have them too, I think. So, yeah, that's awesome. That's going to save a lot of people trouble. And of course, if somebody already has an older gscart switch, you could use this as well. So maybe if you're looking to upgrade, have buy one of the small scart cables and then put it. I would say the old switch is first in line, then into
right,
this
right.
One.
Depends on how you want to organize. Like, right. Let's say you want this sync on green processing here and not here. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you can reorganize it very dynamically.
So I guess the proper thing to do if you have an existing one would be to leave the sync generation off on that, but on the new one. So
right,
the new one
right.
Because
you don't want to do it several times. I know people who did it like 3 or 4 times, so they have all these cables mm-hmm. with active sync stripping. Then it goes through my switch, and then they have xRGB, mm-hmm. and this like active adapter which has one in it. So
geez,
and
terrible.
Some people had problems because of that. So I said like, hey, just if you can maybe unsolder or just order the replacement passive mm-hmm. stuff.
Yeah, so I don't want to get too detailed into this, but using a sync stripper, that typical LM1881 chip that people see in circuits, is different than using sync regeneration in the sync
yes, era. Yes, this is
so
correct.
So you're not spitting out high voltage, you're not delaying the sync, shifting everything over.
It's better, yeah. It's still like pixel or so, or maybe 1.5.
But not the way it was.
Yeah.
And because it's the Altera, you don't have to worry about higher voltages on the output.
Right.
I tested about 900 millivolts coming out with sync regeneration on. I spoke to Marcus, the creator of the open source GAN converter. Mm-hmm. He said it's perfectly fine for this card input of that. All of the data sheets on all of the BVMs and PVMs I've read said that's definitely fine. In fact, some PVMs could take like 150 millivolts all the way up to 8 volts. It's kind of, some of the PVMs were built like tanks. You could put anything. So I think that's good because there are some weird equipment like the Framemeister that doesn't like it when you go too low. So I think that's probably
right.
a good sweet spot for it. It's, you know, all the good equipment's not going to be damaged. So that is very cool that this could really end up not just being a switch, but being something that solves a lot of problems in people's chains. So that's pretty cool. So for the first batch, for the small batch for testers, I guess we're looking at about a month or so before.
I hope it's going to be a week, a week, and I can ship. But as everybody knows, shit happens, and it can get delayed a bit. I'm really looking forward to have it done as soon as possible, because a lot of people are waiting. Everybody is patient except a few. So I'm usually getting emails and I'm trying. So I get different attitudes. So there are people who are kind of making demands.
Yeah, like, but there's one thing you got to realize is, you know, people that are a fan of your work, people that your average person that loves your work, 90% you will never hear from. They're
absolutely.
A fan, they like it, it works, they buy it. You know, maybe you get a thank you email, maybe not, it doesn't matter. And the remaining people are either people like Dave that give good feedback, that, you know, offer suggestions on things, and then the small percentage that have something bad to say. And it's so hard, you gotta remember in your mind, it's so hard to visualize that there's this many people that are super happy and this many people that aren't. And so, it's tough. But sometimes they have good points, sometimes people just like being mean to each other, so whatever. But
yeah, the thing is, sometimes I'm coming tired from work, and I get the email like, hey, you said it's gonna be this, what is the release date, I paid my money, hey, and yeah. I really like straight talk. I like, hey, get straight to the point, you want a refund? Or it's just at this point of time, I cannot tell you the date because I don't have the date. I'm working on it. So it just, everything is estimates. So
yeah.
Just, yeah, but mostly everybody is fine.
It's, you know, the funniest email I've ever gotten was with the switches. It was about a year after I had finished, you were selling them all directly.
Right.
Now. And it was two paragraphs of like, you know, I'm a big supporter of your site, which is funny because at the time I didn't have a Patreon, I didn't have anything, so how are you? You know, I have this great idea, like, check it out, what if, and he essentially wanted you to ship him a Switch for free, and then he was going to pay you, like, $10 a week until he paid it off or something, and I started to respond, like, haven't you ever heard of a credit card? If like, what is, and I just, I stopped, and I was like, it's not worth it, I just said, I'm not selling them anymore, Super G selling them directly, you might want to just post on the forum. And then another long email, like, oh, I have, you know, I've lost all respect for you. That's, you know, you just blew me off, whatever. And then he posted the forums that you were just like, no, I'm not going to send it for free. Like, some people, like, that's one out of the hundreds of people that I've talked to about the Switch. So only one said something like that. But I could not believe some of the funny things like that. But that one took the cake of give it to me for free and I'll pay you $10 a week. As if either of us have the time to chase somebody down for $10 a week for, you know, that one cracked me up. Right. So you also have the gcomp switch.
Yes.
So at the moment, it's four input, one output, yeah, auto switching. We did a lot of testing on that as well. I did both my zoom in testing, and I think we had it on a scope as well at one point. Also super high quality. Now that HD RetroVision has their high quality just component output cables, using those, so you don't have to worry about using crappy cables, because I've been guilty of that before. I've done a setup and just reached into my box, grabbed a set of cables and gone, what's wrong, why does this look weird, and then sure enough it's a bad cable, could throw that out. So now we're both to match, but you've talked about a new version of that.
Yeah, so basically it's because of these guys, and it's gone. People ask for more inputs, and I want to align the architecture with what I have with gscart switch, because electrically it's compatible, and so it's gonna be like the same 8-to-2 switch, and internally it's gonna use the same components, and the plan is even to use the same FPGA firmware. So it's easier for me, and I just feel nice because I'm gonna have like one kind of FPGA core for everything.
That's awesome.
And like, let's say if somehow I have to come up with some fix, it never happened before, but we never know. So it's gonna be one version, and I'm gonna flash one version, and yeah, it's just I will try. I talked a bit about it to my suppliers in China about these. So about these connectors, RCA connectors. So currently, as like all the owners know, so it's a bit tall comparing to a gscart switch. It's tall because connectors I use, these are like old connectors. So they still manufacture for me. So because I ask, I need let's say 1,000, and they manufacture it for me. I want to reduce the height. If they can reduce the height, I can make nice, beautiful, slim version of the switch, and or even make it same height as gscart switch is now, because also gscart switch height is dictated by a scart connector height. So yeah, and it's gonna, these two pieces are gonna match ideally. So
that's awesome.
This is the plan. I hope it's, it will happen.
So will you be continuing to sell the 4x1 version, or is it just going to be the 8x2?
No, it's gonna be 8x2, because as I've said, it's a hassle. Yeah. Just to manage two versions.
I think that, it's my personal opinion, I do talk to a lot of people that do speed running, you know, professional Twitch streamers, but I think that everybody would rather have that version, the 8x2.
Right.
Because even if they don't need it today, it's just, it simplifies things, just having dual outputs. And, you know, it's never a bad thing having more inputs. Even if you only have four consoles with component, who knows? You know, who knows?
Yeah, but now it's not four. Now it's
eight. So there you go. But, yeah, that is very cool. So You have the EXT port on the gscart switch, and I believe you have it on the component switch as well, right?
Yes.
So while the firmware is closed source, I believe you've opened up people to make their own accessories for the EXT port. One person was testing manual push button switch. Mm-hmm. Another person, I think it was the same person, was doing optical audio through it.
I think so, but I'm not even sure that he manufactured PCBs. So we talked, there was some schematics, which I still have to check because I didn't have time really to make sure it's all correct and fine. Mm-hmm. And export will remain just in case. But so far, I would say nobody's using it. So it just people talked about it. Mm-hmm. I haven't seen anything. I haven't seen photos. I didn't get any PMs like telling me that
I think it's still in the prototype phase, but it's very cool that people are able to add things like that to it. Because it's a much smaller use case, but there are people out there that would love a push button for whatever reason. I know I would like the optical switch as well. So I think that's very cool that people are able to build things for it. And I think you've also been willing to work with people for case design. So yeah. I wouldn't call it an open source case, but we've talked to a few people. That guy Ben is going to be looking into making a metal case for it. So anybody that wants to do that. And I think that's cool as hell because I just, you know, most of the time, all I care about is how something works. But if it could look really cool and work well, that's always a nice bonus. So I'm looking forward to see some of the interesting cases people have. People have already done 3D print designs to add mounting. So you
yeah,
can take
brackets,
one of the screws
yeah.
out and you could mount it to a wall. I thought that was really awesome as well. So this is cool. This is, you know, this is... in my opinion, a happy medium between a closed product. It's like a closed product with open options for it. So I like that. People are able to customize it in their own way while still having a solid backbone for it. So that's very cool. Any projected release date for the component switch? I imagine you have to finish all the work on the
yeah, so probably like start of next year, I will start to work on that. So the moment I can mass produce, mass manufacture a gscart switch, so that's done, and then I can work on gcomp.
Awesome.
New gcomp. And yeah, ideally I wanna like just stop it and do something else. Like different stuff. I want that to work. And
you
yeah,
want
but
it to work to the point where you could just have, you know, have it made automatically, you don't have to worry about
yes.
developing anymore.
Yeah. Yeah, it takes a lot of time. Yeah. It's done. It's done, even to assemble a gscart switch, it's 10 minutes. I cannot get it faster.
Oh,
just
yeah.
one switch, it's 18 screws.
Well, the older ones were, the 3.4, that was even longer. And then you have to like, brace your finger in to get all the screws
yes,
in.
Yes,
was,
yes,
at least this one bolts together a lot easier than the originals, so.
Yeah, so, and my wife is doing this assemblies.
Oh, no.
Yeah, she's helping me. So basically, I do less. So I'm doing different stuff. Like, I help whenever I can. She helps when I need some help. So it's like this.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
And your kids get a little older too, you can have them. Everybody have a mini assembly line.
Well, my older daughter tried it and I said, I'm going to pay you $1 per unit. And
oh, that's awesome.
She made two and then she said, no.
love it. So in the future, if once this is kind of running on its own accord, what are things that you were looking into that you'd like to work on? I know we messed with... was it CDI trying to get RGB?
CDI,
out of it.
Right, and then people got service manual, so there is some improvement. Yeah, I would love to add some kind of, to have some small project like this, just to, let's say, replace connector CDI, maybe come up with some circuit board, which you can easily integrate, just to have proper RGB out of CDI. I know it's shitty console and stuff, yeah, but more RGB, the better.
Yeah, exactly. And there are people that love it, like, you know, Yahel from Wrestling with Gaming. The only console powerful enough for him, so that would be
and,
cool.
I have a lot of like plans, but I would say I would like to work more on PlayStation 1, because what I see, like, there is PlayStation 1, there is Xbox, original Xbox, and original Xbox has so many like custom applications and BIOS mods and this and that, and PlayStation 1 didn't get the same treatment. Somehow, I have some ideas, BIOS replacement, making a small PCB, mm-hmm. like in a proper way, so you solder it nice, you have some custom connector, you're going to be able to replace or mod your BIOS chip, also write some software to change something about BIOS.
Very
and
cool.
stuff, and that everybody knows there is a PSNE, it's open source mod chip mm-hmm. project. So I've been doing something, I've been improving the code readability and understanding how it works. And I also, right now when I have some spare time, really spare time, when I don't work on switches, mm-hmm. so I'm designing a small board for ET Tiny microcontroller just to be able to solder it inside the PlayStation 1. Like we used to do with microchip 12C508, like legacy chip, mm-hmm. and port it to like different chips and like make sure it works on all revisions, maybe document stuff. Mm-hmm. And what I have set up is like some small like photo like area where I can make finally high resolution photos of all PlayStation 1 motherboard revisions. Mm-hmm. And it's just for modding, just for mod chipping. Say this is your diagram, those are the points. So, because when you wanna, right now it's a mess. When you wanna solder something, you have to Google a lot, you have to search for diagrams, you have to ask on forums what should go where.
I found mislabeled diagrams as well. I did a mod chip a couple years ago for my cousin's PS1, the mini PS1, and I started soldering it, and the final point looked different. And I checked, and it was they had labeled the guide wrong, so I had to remove everything. And you know, I got like four wires in, and I just and those are small points to solder to. It's not like
right.
It's not easy. It's not like an Atari 2600 where you know the vias are this big. it's tiny little points. So yeah, it's good. Good documentation and a good open chip like that would be pretty cool. And that would be for region-free BIOS, and I would assume for CDRs as well, so you could use backups on it.
Yeah.
That's cool. Yeah, it's tricky nowadays because a lot of times you can buy a PlayStation 1 from a game store, you open it up and there's already a mod chip in there.
Then you have no idea what it is. Yeah.
You have no idea what it is, if it was installed correctly, you know, if it's going to cause any issues. So a lot of people, if they don't recognize the mod chip itself, just take it out. They'd rather not risk ruining a perfectly good console for something that was installed badly. So, you know, and if it's a small, cheap PCB, I think most fans, even if they bought one and found one in it, would probably take that out and would rather put a good solution
right.
in its place. So, that's awesome. Are you going to... Is that just going to be something you throw up on OSH Park for people, put it on GitHub?
Oh, it's going to be, like, absolutely open source. There is no any business interest in it. It's just... like PlayStation 1 is one of my favorite consoles, mm-hmm. and really when I see like a original Xbox community, mm-hmm. when I see PlayStation 1 community, so there is so much love for Xbox, mm-hmm. and like for PlayStation 1, it's you have a bit of information everywhere, but you don't have like any central place.
Yeah.
Like for all like information, photos, how-tos, and constantly people are asking how should I install it, mm-hmm. where should I solder it, what are the revisions, what if I have this revision, what if I have like early Japanese, which is really not even sorted out like 100%.
Yeah.
So there is a lot of stuff.
Well, I'm working on the place to go to put that information. I'm talking to people now, so hopefully by the time you get to that, there will be an open wiki that will have everybody that's an expert in their field be posting stuff in each relevant section.
And so. That would be nice, because I wanted to talk to you about it, about having some place, because I have my small, humble G-Retro stuff, but this is not really a right place to put the information in, so...
Yeah, well, you always have a place on RetroRGB, but I also want to make sure that there's the open wiki, you know, community run, that everybody could post their own information on it. So I think it's very important, I think it's missing, and luckily a lot of people agree, and I'm starting to get the right people who are excellent web developers, who have a background in this. We're all starting to talk now about making this together, so it's pretty cool. I'm pretty excited. So hopefully by the time that's around, we'll have a nice place to post all this stuff. And I'm going to donate every guide. I'm going to rewrite on this new site that I have on mine just to make sure, because, you know, people don't seem to realize how important archiving this information is for preservation or just for fun, just if you want to mod any of these consoles. So I want to make sure, you know, there's all that info out there, and even especially too for the Switch stuff, you know, I want a page dedicated so people know how to use them. People could recognize the model differences, the dip switch settings. So that's cool. Yeah, hopefully we'll all be able to contribute to this stuff.
Yep.
And now with Microsoft owning GitHub, who knows what's going to happen a few years from now. Yeah. I don't trust that.
We will move somewhere else, just in case.
Yeah, everybody said, oh, you know, it's not a big deal. They'll be fine, but they ruined Skype. So who knows what else they're going to do. So I think I hit all the questions I wanted to ask. Was there anything that you wanted to say that I forgot to talk about, or any other announcements that you wanted people to know, or did we cover it all?
No, I think we are fine for the moment. Thing is, if I make another announcement, people are going to start ask about it. And I'm going to get this. I hate this pressure when, it's like so many people are waiting. My PayPal account is.
Yeah,
it's really there is some trust and I deliver, but it's just for me. It's like having so many people waiting for the stuff is just makes me uncomfortable.
No, I completely understand.
Yeah,
so.
There is pressure. Yeah, I hate pre-orders. If I have like some extra money.
Yeah, it's nerve-wracking. But actually, that is one thing that maybe I didn't clarify in the interview that I've talked about on the podcast before, but the end goal with the gscarts is once you have this small batch of the 5.1s out and get your feedback from people, make sure there's no weird bugs or anything, then it's going to go into mass production, so there are going to be no more pre-orders, right? You're going to really aim...
Yeah, I plan to cover the, all pre-orders which I have today, plus some extra units just in case, and then hopefully I'm gonna keep them coming.
So you track the metric and say, all right, well I'm down to this many, and it takes this long to order the batch, so I'll order now. So the goal is to within a year to have constant stock, so you're always able.
Yes,
to fill.
So I did it previously when I had some extra money, but now I was doing home repairs and it's so expensive, and I just don't have any extra money, so.
Yeah, I mean, that's a big risk, buying too much of something and then having stock of it and having to wait and deal with it. So I completely understand why you don't have 1,000 switches sitting in the corner of your house right now. But yeah, that's cool. That's a good goal to aim for because, that's all things in the retro gaming world, or I guess any kind of electronics that aren't run by a big company. It is frustrating for newcomers that haven't been following it for a while. Where they go, all right, well, what do I need? And they find all of the things that they need and they can't buy them. So it's cool that you're aiming for full stock of this. But. All right, well, thank you so much for doing this. I'm glad we finally get to talk. I'll have this up, audio and video, plus links to where you can pre-order the switches, pictures and examples of how badass these things are. And I'll keep everybody posted as to your progress.
Yep, thanks.
Yeah, thank you.